My name is Yara Lee. I was born and raised in Brazil. I'm of Korean descent, and I'm a filmmaker, activist, philanthropist, kind of like, working in this three-prong way of documenting and supporting activism. And also, I run a foundation, so we are sometimes able to even do grant-making programs where we find people that deserve support and activists doing great work, confrontational work, and then we are able to kind of support them through the foundation. So it's very nice to be able to do the three things, yeah.
Yesterday, your movie Cultures of Resistance was shown here at Elevate Festival in Graz. So my question is, why do you chose to make it that way that you have a lot of countries you're portraying and the problems? Why do you choose to take a lot of countries and not focusing on one or maybe two?
Yeah, I was trying to figure out what is this film I'm making, and then I realized I was trying to do some sort of like a quilt editing, where you have all these patches that become a mosaic, like a blanket with all the different parts, because I felt like we needed to have a little bit of a snapshot, and I just felt it was interesting to be able to interconnect the conflicts going on around the world and how we are involved and how we are part of that and what can we do to like provoke change, And I decided to take the path of creativity, how people like use music, film, photography, dance to promote peace and justice, And then I felt it was interesting to be able to like, because I travel a lot and I felt like it through my journeys, I kept meeting interesting people and I felt like, wow, it would be nice to like inspire people to show that everybody can do a little something, I was very against this whole like invading and occupying Iraq, and since then I've been investigating what people from the Middle East think about all these issues and Africa and the global South in general, and then I wanted to share with people all these stories that I encounter and people I met, and I purposely didn't want to have like activist superstars. I didn't want to have like Mandela or Desmond Tutu, Bono, U2, because I felt it was important to show on the grassroots level how normal people can be engaged. You don't need to be a full-time activist or a full-time public figure. You can be someone who has even a corporate job or someone who has a regular life and still do something, It's a film that will continue to be quilt editing. It will continue to be a work in progress because as world affairs evolve, the film can also evolve. So it's a little bit of a different style of filmmaking that kind of tries to adapt to the velocity of change in the world, The cultures of resistance gave a snapshot overview, but certain conflicts are so crazy and so like unacceptable that I will go deeper, in particular the Congo, when I was doing all these investigations and, kept reading about like almost 6 million people killed in the last 10 years. I was just like, this is just unacceptable, We need to bring more awareness and more action to stop the craziness. And obviously I can't make like a full-length documentary on each of the segments, but I will be choosing a couple, which in this particular case is going to be the Congo and Afghanistan, and I'll be devoting a lot of time in 2011. So it's nice, Cultures of Resistance gives you a snapshot. And then we have a couple other projects coming, The Deep Profession. We also make short films for like campaigns, if we want to help the indigenous people, for example, in the Amazon, we made a short film that they can show around, and NGOs around the world working for indigenous rights, they present in conferences.
There is this argument of people saying, well, it's great to raise awareness with grassroots movements, but still, like the roots and the structural problems want change. You have to go into politics. So, what do you answer to that?
Yeah, it's frustrating because, we had millions of people on the street protesting against the invasion of Iraq, and we felt like, wow, we always talk about democracy and governments are supposed to represent what people want, and, the US government still went there and attacked Iraq. So that was a big blow for the peace movement, People were like, oh, grassroots, And even in my journeys, as you see in the film, I met a lot of people frustrated because they've been using nonviolence and, the army and the governments don't respect corporations. They just go and kill nonviolent activists, So a lot of them are just like, oh, we're going with our guns now, But at the end of the day, you're not going to make real progress if you're going to resort to violence. You know, if the military is practicing state terrorism through governments, you're not going to be able to bring that kind of government down by just having, you know, the same amount of weapons. You know, it's just marching towards self-destruction. But I think it's a combination of all. You know, you have to work with the grassroots, you have to work with political, you know, figures that have the power of changing legislation. And then when you get the legislation, you have to really work hard to have these laws implemented. So many countries I go, on paper, you have the law, but who's practicing that law, you know? If you are in a global solidarity movement where you have so many nationalities involved, then people will feel connected and then we'll be able to work in coherence and in cohesion, you know? But if it's just isolated patches, then it's hard. But if we work in unison, we can make things happen, you know?
What is the role of the United Nations? What do you think? Do you think it doesn't do anything or not enough?
The United Nations became such a bureaucratic body, and it's just really, really, like, you know, when we first started the World Social Forum, the slogan was, another world is possible. And then later on, we had this slogan, another UN is possible. We just need to, like, revamp this whole UN thing, because it's just like it's a body that is supposed to be, like, you know, supporting international law and, you know, bringing, like, independent investigations to the world. And they always get stuck, you know, all these powerful forces behind, and they just cannot move. They have this very limited action. Yeah, and it's really sad. Like, you know, we have in the Congo, for example, just a few weeks ago, we had this gang rape, you know. It was right next to the UN. By the time they, like, you know, synchronized, all the women were raped already, you know. So it's very frustrating. But again, I think it's not about just sitting and complaining and feeling useless and powerless. You know, if the government in the Congo and the UN, they're not able to stop and protect civilians, we women have to go and do something. So we had thousands of women who came from 52 countries. It is the Women's World March, you know, and we were there. You know, we protest against sexual violence, you know, and we need to work together as women and show solidarity. So I think that's basically what it comes down to. When we see things are not happening, we have to go and unite with other powerful forces in the grassroots movement and provoke change ourselves.